ready on tonight.
Yes.
I encourage everyone to stand on tonight. We're ready to praise God and to worship our Father on tonight for all the great things that He has done. He's done great things, great things, great things for the people of greater love. Amen.
Amen.
Psalms 96, verse 1. Are we ready?
Yes.
Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord. Sing unto the Lord, bless His name. Show forth His salvation from day to day. Declare His glory among the heathen, His wonders among all the people. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before Him. Strength and beauty are in His sanctuary. Give unto the Lord, O ye kindreds of the people. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto His name. Bring an offering and come into His courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Fear before Him all the earth. Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world also shall be established that it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. Let the heavens rejoice, that the earth be glad, let the sea roar and the fullness thereof. Let the field be joyful and all that is therein. Then shall all the trees of the wood rejoice. Before the Lord, for He cometh to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the people with His truth. Amen, amen, amen. We bless you, Father. We praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. But you reign all the earth, Lord Jesus. And we bless you, Father. We come with praise and worship, Father, to you on tonight, God. And we are ready, Father. We're ready in your presence, Lord, to open our mouths and give you all the praise that's due to you, Lord. Oh, God, we worship you. We worship you, Lord. We worship you today, Lord. You are great and mighty, God. We worship you, Father. We honor you and we reverence you on tonight, Lord Jesus. Oh God, you are great, you are great, you are great, Lord. And you are greatly to be praised on tonight, Father. Are we ready on tonight? We bless your name, Jesus. We come to praise you, Lord. We come to praise you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Jesus. Bless you, Lord.
Oh,
Yeah. Lord. You reign, Father. Lord, we bless you, Father. All power and authority, Father. We thank you, Lord. We bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless you, Lord. You reign, Lord Jesus. Oh, God, you reign and we worship you, Lord. We bless you, Father. Oh, we honor you on tonight, Lord. We bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to you, Lord.
Rising,
rising and falling at your word. I hear you responding. My God, how great you are.
You reign, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. How great you are, Father. You are great. You are great, and we know you to be great, Lord Jesus. Oh, we bless you, Father. We bless your name, Jesus. There is none like you, Father. We worship you, Father. You reign, Lord. You reign, Lord Jesus. And we bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, Father. Come on, let's just pray in the Spirit for a minute. Yes,
Oh, bless you, Father.
Bless
you, Holy Spirit, thank you for everything that we will hear on tonight.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Amen.
Teach us, Holy Spirit, thank you for everything that you've already spoken in this place. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for everything you've already said, everything you've already revealed, and everything that will be spoken, and we decree that we have ears to hear what you are saying to us. And in advance, we say thank you.
Yes,
Father.
Amen.
Father. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
Yes. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Bless you, Lord.
Bless you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, thank you, Father. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Somebody, please cut on the lights.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Father. All right.
Bless you, Lord.
God is good.
Amen. Yes, He is.
Amen. Yes, He is.
God is good.
Yes, He is.
Yes, Lord.
God.
Yes.
If you could just take a few moments just to think about His goodness.
Yes.
All right. Thank you, Father. All right. Tonight, y'all, we will be talking about humility, love, and faith. And the anointing and your God-given authority. But we're going to mostly focus on humility. That's where the Lord has had me at all year. Okay? With humility and with love. Mm-hmm. And you know, okay? So I can only give to you what He's been giving to me.
Mm-hmm.
I can't give you anything else. And I promise you that it's good. Mm-hmm. I promise you that it's good. All right? All right, so we will start in Proverbs 22:4. At least it's been good to me.
Yeah,
it's been good to me. And it's been really helping me along the way this year. I tell you, when you get the word, if you apply it, it'll help you out along the way.
Yes. Amen.
My God. God is good.
Amen.
God is good. My God is good.
Yes,
He is. All right. Proverbs 22:4 says, by humility and the fear of the Lord, by humility and the fear of the Lord, are riches and honor and life. All right, and last Sunday we started talking about the authority of the believer. Okay, and we touched briefly on something called the fear of the Lord or the reverence of the Lord. This scripture tells us that by humility and the fear of the Lord are riches, abundance of harvest, and honor, abundance of harvest, and life. Abundance of harvest. All right. Now, being humble says, God, I know your place and I know my place.
Uh-huh.
And my place is under you in all things. All right. Remember, one of the things the pastor said was you have authority and you can exercise authority as long as you remain under authority.
All right.
So being humble says, I know your place, God. I know mine.
Mm-hmm.
I know mine is under you. And I'm going to keep you in your place, which is first, above all and in all things.
Mm-hmm.
That's above what I want included now.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to stay in my place under you, regardless of what I feel or what I think. I'm going to stay in my place and I'm going to keep you in your place.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to obey you and do what you say.
Yes.
Now, if y'all remember last year, the Holy Spirit taught us about the humble person. He likes to be close to the humble person. They're teachable. They're leadable. They're willing to bow. They're willing to bring themselves low under Him and do whatever He tells them to do at all times. Okay? Now, there are vast benefits to being humble of heart, all right? There are many, many benefits throughout the word to being humble. And to those who have this awesome God-given characteristic, it's a God-given characteristic, okay? Because you're not going to find those in the world being humble, being teachable, being leadable. You're not going to find the disobedient being humble, teachable, or leadable. You're not going to find them doing that, okay? It is a God-given characteristic. All right. Now, to those who are humble and to those who remain humble towards God, there are many, many benefits. And even to those who are willing to humble themselves under him and his word, who have not been before, if you find yourself in a place of being disobedient, or if you find yourself putting yourself in his place and putting him on the back burner, if you are willing to get things in line, which is what he's been saying to us all month, if you're willing to humble yourself, you can experience these vast benefits, right? Now, I like benefits.
That's right.
Y'all like benefits? I like benefits. Benefits are all right with me. All right? Let's go to Psalms 25:8-9. All right, Psalms 25:8-9. We'll go there first. Let's look at some of the benefits briefly of being humble. Good and upright is the Lord. Mm-hmm. See, the Lord is good, y'all.
Yeah, he is.
Good and upright is the Lord. Mm-hmm. Therefore, will he teach sinners in the way. All right? One of the benefits of being humble is that God teaches you. He'll teach you his ways. Mm-hmm. Even if you're in the way of error. If you're willing to humble yourself, he'll teach you his ways. Yeah. And if you're already walking in his ways, he'll reveal more to you along the way. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God, it's so good. Let's go to Proverbs 11:2. It's good to be taught of the Lord.
That's right.
Yeah. It's good to be a student of the Lord. I mean, he knows everything. He knows everything. He has all kinds of wisdom, advanced wisdom. He's able to lead you and direct you into stuff, around stuff. I mean, what else could you want? It's good to be taught of the Lord.
Yes, amen.
God is good.
Yes,
oh, my God. Proverbs 11:2. When pride cometh, then cometh shame. We learned about the prideful kind when we learned about the humble. We won't focus on them too much tonight. Because God don't like to be in the company of the proud. Mm-hmm. He loves everybody.
Yeah.
Don't get it twisted.
Right.
But the word says that he's close to the humble. Mm-hmm. The pride, he knows them from afar.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not good to be afar off from God.
No, it's not.
That's not a good thing. Mm-hmm. So when pride cometh, then cometh shame. But with the lowly is wisdom. All right, so it's all kinds of wisdom available to you when you're willing to humble yourself. God makes wisdom available to you, wisdom that's hid up in him for you, for your life. In this life, we need wisdom.
Yes.
We just don't know everything. We don't know every turn. We can't see what's at the end of every decision.
That's right.
You know, you just can't.
That's right.
But if you're close to God, and you're humble, and you're leadable, and you're teachable, and you're willing to listen and be obedient to him, my God, he can take you around traps. He can take you into open doors of favor, my God. He's good.
Amen.
Let's go to James 4:10. All types of wisdom, so you never have to guess. You never have to do the hit or miss thing. You never have to try this or try that. I'm talking about exact knowledge for your life.
Amen.
Yes.
That is priceless. Exact knowledge for your life. There's no price that can be put on that. And it's available to the humble heart. James 4:10 says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. When God lifts you up, there is exaltation. There is honor. Oh, my God, there's favor coming from the right and the left. He gives you favor not only with him, but also with men.
Yes, that's right.
When he honors you and when he lifts you up, and it doesn't matter what your current status is in life.
That's right.
He can take somebody that's broke on the street and lift them up to the place of being a millionaire and being a blessing to everybody else, if they're humble. Let's go to Proverbs 29:23. Proverbs 29:23. We're just talking about some of the benefits of being humble. There's benefits to being humble. There's benefits to it. A man's pride shall bring him low. My God. The man's pride shall bring him low. But honor shall uphold the humble in spirit. A man's pride will bring him to shame. It'll bring him to shame. But honor upholds the humble in spirit. God honors you when you're humble. And I tell you, it's a big difference between people honoring you and him honoring you.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. Amen.
Big difference.
Big difference, yeah.
Big difference, yes. My God. Mm-hmm.
When you work on a job for a year, you do a good job. Depending upon what kind of job it is, they give you a 25-cent raise, and that's how they honor you.
That's how they honor you. Yeah, that's right.
But when God honors you, when God honors you, stuff is just coming from everywhere.
Amen.
You just can't say nothing else, but God, you are good.
Yes, right. Amen.
Open doors, favors, love sums of money. People want to do this for you and do that for you. I'm like, my God. Oh,
yes.
What else are you going to do? I don't want to miss anything.
That's right.
All right, let's go to 2 Chronicles 7 and 14. That's for the humble. That's for the humble. That's for the humble people, y'all.
That's right. Amen.
Come on.
If my people, which are called by name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. All right, so God says here that when you're willing to humble yourself and pray and seek his face and turn from your own ways or from not being humble, then will he hear from heaven. He will forgive, his mercy endures forever, and he will heal their lands. So here we're not just talking about your life, because when you think about lands, it's not just you. Each one of us has been planted somewhere amongst people.
Amen.
All right? In Suffolk, in Norfolk, in Portsmouth, wherever. Out there, you know, wherever you're planted at. So now we're talking about the healing of the people around you, of the people you're connected to, restoration, signs, wonders, miracles. He said he will hear from heaven and heal your lands. Not just you, but your lands.
Amen.
Come on. So I think we need to be humble.
Amen. Come on.
If we're not, and if you are, stay humble. Yeshua was humble. He was our, he is our example. All right? We don't compare ourselves to one another. Yeshua is your example. Okay? He was humble. Let's go to Matthew 11, 29 and 30. Yeshua was a humble person here in the earth. Matthew 11, 29. Thank you, Pastor.
Oh.
All right. Take my yoke upon you. These words are written in red. They're black up here on the screen, but they're written in red in your Bibles. All right? This is Yeshua talking. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Look at me. Come and learn from me. For I am meek and lowly in heart. That lowly in heart and meek means humble. I am meek and lowly in heart. And you shall find rest unto your souls.
Yes,
for my yoke is easy, and my burden is light.
Yes.
So being humble causes you not to be burdened down with heavy burdens. It causes you to experience supernatural help.
Yes.
Makes your burdens light. And it is mighty light when God is carrying it and you are.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
It's mighty light, God. Yeshua was humble unto the point of physical death. Let's go to Philippians 2 and 1. He was humble unto, not just humble, but humble to the point of death. All right? He said, I only speak those words that I hear my Father say. He wasn't out here speaking his own words. Not that he didn't have his own thoughts. He said he had many things to say, but he only spoke what he heard his Father say. He only did what his Father told him to do. And he always did those things that pleased his Father.
Yeah.
And he wasn't just that humble. What is that? To only say what the Holy Spirit tells you to say.
Yeah.
What is that? Yeah. To only say what he tells you to say. He wasn't just that humble and leadable and teachable in the earth in his ministry, but even unto the point of death. Even to the point of the cross. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort and love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy. This fulfills our Father's joy. That you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. But in loneliness, humbleness of mind, let each esteem each better than themselves.
Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. He was equal with God. Being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, and it still is, but made himself of no reputation. Humble people don't make themselves of any reputation.
That's right.
And took upon him the form of a servant. Everybody wants to lead, but who wants to serve?
Mm-hmm.
And took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross.
Mm-hmm.
And because he did, God also have highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father.
Mm-hmm.
God desires to make your name great too.
Yes.
He desires to make every single one of our names great too. He desires to make you great. He desires to turn the power up on your words. We're talking about the authority of the believer.
Mm-hmm.
Who would like to say it, see a thing and say it?
Mm-hmm.
I like seeing things. I like saying and seeing. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
I like it. I'm at the place in my life where I need to be able to say it and see it.
Yeah,
my
amen,
God.
Amen.
Because as prophets say it, stuff isn't coming from you. Your heart is supernatural now.
Mm-hmm.
So I need to see it and say it.
Uh-huh.
And say it and see it.
Yes.
He desires to turn the power upon your words. He desires to expand your territory and influence for his kingdom and bless you. He desires to really enrich your life. I told you he's good.
Yes,
you know he is.
Yes,
but he can only do this in the life of a humble person. He can only do this in the life of a humble person. All right, so let's go to Mark 9 and 35. Let's go to Mark 9 and 35. Mark 9 and 35. Bless you, Lord. And he sat down and called the 12. And he saith unto them, if any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all.
Mm-hmm.
See, the one that God makes the greatest has to make himself servant of all. The greatest is servant of all, lowest of all. Here it is, loveliest of all.
Yes.
Of all. They take no thought for themselves whatsoever. In God's eyes, that's the greatest. In God's eyes, that's the vessel I want to use right there. Every time. For everything. Take no thought for themselves whatsoever. They make themselves of no reputation to themselves or anyone else. They know that they are not responsible for anything concerning themselves, saints, including their reputation. Sometimes we care too much what other people think about us.
Right.
And you think too much about yourself.
Yes. Uh-huh.
But the servant of all, they don't care. They don't care. They don't take no thought. I'm not even responsible for my reputation, whether you think good or whether you think bad.
Right.
I'm not responsible for it. They know that they are nothing, absolutely nothing without God. Nothing without grace, nothing without Yeshua, and they can do nothing without him. So again, whether people say something good or whether they say something bad, it don't matter.
No.
Whether they think something good or think something bad, it don't matter. Whether they do something good or do something bad towards you, don't none of that matter. What is that to me? I'm on my Lord's business. I'm on my Lord's business, and I'm responsible for being on his business.
Yeah.
I'm not responsible for what you think or what you say or what you do. I'm responsible for me. And he told me to be about his business. I'm on assignment, and I don't answer to you. I'm not your servant, and who are you that you would judge another man's servant? But I don't answer to you. I answer to God. So why do I care what you think good or bad? If someone thinks or feels the worst of me, I love them. This is the mindset of a humble person. If someone thinks or feels the worst of me, they think the worst of my intentions or my motives, I love them. I pray for them and bless them because that's what my Lord has told me to do.
Mm-hmm.
And if someone thinks the best of me, if they know that I have all of the best intentions and motives, you know what? I love them, I pray for them, and I bless them. Because that's what my Lord has told me to do. And I give him all the glory out of the way. If I bear the reproach of Christ to those in the world, another world, and my spirit is glad of a surety, I know I am his, and the enemy knows it too. And if someone thinks well of me, where else do I got to boast? What do I got to brag about? It's the grace of Yeshua on me making me look good to them. All they see is what he's doing to me. So the only one I can make my boast in really is Yeshua.
Yeah.
This is the humble person. If you think the worst, then I must be the savior of death to you. The word says me the savior of death to some, the savior of life to others. But either way, it's not on me. I'm just doing what God told me to do. Humble people do not have an opinion. They don't have a point of view. They don't have a perspective. You know how some people say, well, this is my thing with the situation. They don't have a thing. They don't have a, this is my thing. No, humble people don't have a thing. Humble people don't have a point. This is where I'm coming from. They don't have a place that they're coming from. They don't. They just do what they are told to do, period, point blank. That's what humble people do. They do what God tells them to do. And you know what? They do things they don't want to do. They do things that their flesh doesn't want to do. This goes beyond reading my Bible when you tell me to cut off the TV. This goes beyond getting up and praying in the morning when I want to be asleep at 5 in the morning. This goes beyond praying in the spirit. This goes beyond cutting the TV off. It goes beyond that. Humble people go back and say they are sorry.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. They sure do. Mm-hmm.
In order to make peace.
Yes. Amen. That's right.
Ooh.
Yes. Amen.
Be humble. In order to make peace.
Uh-huh.
When they feel and know that they're not wrong, when they've been wrong, huh, prophets? When they've been wrong, they go back and say, you know what, I'm sorry.
Sorry, that's right.
Humble people don't lash back when they're being cursed out.
That's right.
No, they bless. They bless. Humble people go back to places that they have left when told to, not to rule or to prove or to argue their own point, because remember, they don't have one.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But to serve in what seems like a lesser position.
Yes.
Huh? Right, Pastor? Won't he tell you to go back and sit down and shut up? My God. And you know what? They'll do it without complaining, without griping. They will do it through tears, through hurts and pain, snotting, screaming and hollering. But you know what? In the end, they're going to get up and go, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Saying, God, if this is what you want me to do, then this is what I will do.
That's right.
Because it's not about my will. It's not about me. It's not about what I want. It's about your will and what you want, God.
Amen.
And what I want is to be obedient to you.
That's right.
Father, I love you. I worship you, so I will obey you.
Amen.
And they don't care what they look like. People might be calling them stupid. You stupid for doing that.
Amen.
I wouldn't do that. They don't care how they look.
That's right. Amen. Amen. That's right.
Didn't it say that it was like he was dumb before his shearers? He didn't care how he looked up there on that cross, knowing that he was God, knowing that he didn't do anything wrong. He didn't care. They don't care what they look like to anybody. Understand this. They don't care what anybody thinks. Abraham didn't want to offer up Isaac. You know, he waited a long time for Isaac. He waited a long time for that boy. He did not want to offer him up. Esther did not want to go before the king. She could have lost her life. She could have lost her life for going before him. All right? Moses didn't want to lead God's people out of Egypt. I don't know how many times Moses told him to get somebody else. All right? Yeshua didn't want to go to the cross. But they did. They did. And in each case, and in, even in ours as well, whole nations were dependent on them being obedient.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Whole nations. Depending on their acts of obedience to God. Let's go to 1 Peter 4:17. So humble people do stuff they don't want to do. My God. 1 Peter 4:17. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God, y'all. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end of them be that obey not the gospel of God? Whew. And if the righteous scarcely be saved, what shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him and well-doing as unto a faithful creator. We are in a time now, saints, in case you didn't know. This is your public announcement. That we are in a time where you would either humble yourself or be humbled. If you call by his name. If you want his. You either going to humble yourself or you going to be humbled. God wants his will done in the earth. And he needs those who are his in position. Either you going to humble yourself or you going to be humbled speedily and quickly. I can speak from being in both places.
Amen.
That it's better when you humble yourself.
Yeah.
It's better when you humble yourself than when you are being humbled by God.
Amen.
I can speak from being in both places. Neither will feel good. Neither will. Neither. Not, it's not going to feel good. But it is so good for you.
Yes.
It is so good for you. And with each step you take in humbling yourself in the process of bringing yourself, your thoughts, your own righteousness, and your opinions, and your own ways lower and lower and lower and lower before him, it causes you to be that much closer to glory, to the spirit without measure, as we heard about Sunday, to manifestation, to minister in the gospel of Yeshua with evidence. With evidence. All right? That's what a true witness is. We're witnesses for God. But a true witness is able to come with the ability to provide evidence that whatever is coming out of their mouth is true.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So when you tell people you're blessed, you really can be a blessing.
Right.
All right? That's what humbling yourself gets you.
Mm-hmm.
When you tell people that God heals, he tells you to lay your hand and speak the word and I will heal. And you're able to provide them evidence. He desires to do these things through you, but you have to be humble.
Yes.
You got to be humble.
Mm-hmm.
Bless you, Father. Mm-hmm. God is near to the humble. Let's go to Psalm 73 and 18. He's near to the humble. Remember, we are saying that in the beginning. He's near to the humble. God's close to the humble.
Mm-hmm.
He's close to the humble.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, think about it in your own case. Wouldn't you automatically just go to the one that always does what you tell them to do?
Yes.
Who wants to fight with somebody?
Mm-hmm.
Who wants to fight and struggle with somebody to get them to do something? Psalm 73 and 18. Who wants to fight? I'm going to the child that I know that's just going to do it without a problem. Nobody got time to argue with nobody. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. Thou casteth them down into destruction. This is what happens to the disobedient. This is what happens to the prideful. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment. I just told you we're in a time where either you're going to humble yourself or you're going to be humbled because God wants you in position. They are utterly consumed with terrors. As a dream of one awaketh, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee. Now this is the sound of a person who's being humble or humbling themselves. So foolish was I and ignorant. I'm sorry, Lord. I repent. I was as a beast before thee. Nevertheless, I am continually with thee. Thou hast holden me by my right hand. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes, ma'am. Who have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. My flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a-whoring from thee, but it is good for me to draw near to God.
Yes.
And the only way you can draw near to God is by humbling yourself, but through humility. I put my trust in the Lord God, and I may declare all thy works.
Mm-hmm.
We are being called to a greater level of consistency and being obedient, because he desires to show forth a greater measure of his spirit through you. Stop the adultery. Hold on. Stop the spiritual adultery.
Yes.
Any form of adultery in the natural starts with spiritual adultery first. All right? Now we're going to James 4:1-10. James 4:1-10. But in your own time, you can write this down, read Jeremiah 2. And it talks about spiritual adultery. Some of the things that God mentions over there that he was getting with the people of Israel with through Jeremiah, he mentions the nature of a camel, how she's sniffing at the wind and going after this one and going after that one. Then he mentions the nature of a donkey over there. You know, a donkey, the donkeys are the most stubborn animal that God has created. And he says she's going after this one, going after that one, all kinds of idols here and there. You know, and we don't have little teeny wooden images or porcelain images for everything. But as we learned in the beginning of the month, people can have all types of things in God's place.
That's right.
Job, wife, husband, kids, things, whatever. You can have it in a place that it's not supposed to be in. And if you put anything in God's place, you have made it an idol.
Yeah.
And God is going to snatch it out of there, because he's not going to have any other gods before him. All right? He also talks over there in Jeremiah about his people forgetting him days without number. Days without number. Days going past. And you're not communing with me. You're not fellowshipping with me. All right? So you read that in your own time, and it'll help you to understand spiritual adultery and why the Holy Spirit wrote this in here, stop the adultery. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your lust that war in your members? Can we go back and do this in the Amplified? Can I have this in the Amplified version, please? James 4. And you can just keep it in Amplified for this one. What leads to strife? What leads to strife? We've been hearing a lot about strife, right?
Yeah.
I mean, God has been lacing everything with love ever since this year got in here. We've been hearing a lot about strife and staying out of it and steering clear of it at all costs. What leads to strife, though? What leads to discord and feuds? And how do conflicts, quarrels, and fightings originate among you? How do they even begin among you? Do they not arise from your sensual desires that are ever warming in your bodily members? You are jealous and covet what others have, and your desires go unfulfilled, so you become murderers. To hate is to murder as far as your hearts are concerned. You burn with envy and anger and are not able to obtain the gratification and contentment and the happiness that you seek, so you fight a war with your mouth. You do not have because you do not ask. Or you do ask God for them and yet fail to receive because you ask the wrong purpose and evil, selfish motives. Your intention is when you get what you desire to spend it in sensual pleasures. You are like unfaithful wives having with the world and breaking your marriage vow to God. Do you not know that being the world's friend is being God's enemy? And when he says the world's friend, he's not talking about worldly things. He's talking about the spirit of the world, the ways of the world. Acting like they act, thinking like they think, talking how they talk, carrying on and conducting yourselves the way that they do. All right? We're called to a higher level of life than that. We're called to a higher lifestyle than that. Do you not know that being the world's friend is being God's enemy? So whoever chooses to be a friend of the world takes his stand as an enemy of God. Or do you suppose that the scripture is speaking to no purpose that says the spirit whom he has caused to dwell in us yearns over us, and he yearns for the spirit to be welcomed with a jealous love, requiring exclusive loyalty is what that jealous means. All right? But he gives us more and more grace, power of the Holy Spirit, to meet this evil tendency and all others fully. This is why he says, God sets himself against the proud and haughty, but gives grace continually to the lowly, those who are humble enough to receive it. So be subject to God.
Resist the devil, stand firm against him, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and he will come close to you. Recognize that you are sinners. Get your soul hands clean. Realize that you have been disloyal, wavering individuals with divided interests, and purify your hearts of your spiritual adultery. As you draw near to God, be deeply penitent and grieved and weep over your disloyalty. Let your laughter be turned to grief and your mirth to dejection and heartfelt shame for your sins. Humble yourselves, feeling very insignificant in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. He will lift you up and make your lives significant. My brother, do not speak evil about or accuse one another. This is what it's all about. He that maligns a brother or judges his brother is maligning and criticizing the law and judging the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a practicer of the law, but a censor and a judge of it. That's what it's all about. Where is humility needed at right now? Where is humility? Where do we have to bring ourselves low before God right now in obedience to that commandment? Where? All right? We only got two commandments, love and faith. And I can tell you right now, there's nothing wrong with your faith. There's nothing wrong with anybody's faith in here, all right? Your faith is always working to bring to pass what you believe. It's always working. Let's go to Luke 17 and 6. Luke 17 and 6. Your faith always does what it's supposed to do. All right? It's a law. Remember, the law is automatic. So your faith, is nothing wrong with your faith. It works. And the Lord said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say unto this sycamore tree, be thou plucked up by the root and be thou planted in the sea, and it should obey you. All right? But which of you having a servant plowing or feeding cattle will say unto him by and by when he has come from the field, go and sit down with me. All right, you done come in from working, go ahead and sit down and relax. And will not rather say unto him, make ready wherewith I may sup and gird thyself and serve me till I have eaten and drunken, and afterward thou shalt eat and drink. Doth he thank that servant because he did the things were commanded of him? I trow not, or I think not. That's what the Lord said. So likewise, when you should have done all those things which are commanded of you, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done that which was our duty to do. Your faith is always doing what it's supposed to do. All right? It's always doing what it's supposed to do. Okay, so when it says if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, it's talking about the purity of it. You have pure faith on the inside of you. Let's go to Romans 12. Romans 12 and 1. You have God's own pure faith on the inside of you. You have it inside you. He didn't give you a different kind of faith. He gave you his own. I beseech you therefore, brother, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That's the issue right there. It's not your faith. It's what you got your faith in. You need to renew your mind and get it in the word of God. But your faith is producing what you believe. It's always producing. For I say, though the grace given unto me, that every man that is among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. And it was the measure of his own faith that he gave you. His own faith. Let's go to John 1. Let's go to John 1 and 1. All right? It's not your faith. You have to deal with your mind and renew it and get your faith over in the word of God and obey the Holy Ghost. Instead of keeping your faith in the worst possible outcome, which is what the enemy tells you and shows you. All right? Get your faith out of the worst possible outcome. Get your faith out of nothing happening. Get your faith out of that. Get it in the word of God and your faith to produce what the word of God says you should have. But your faith is always working. It's always working. This is what you have on the inside of you. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
That's what's on the inside of you, saints. So when you read in Genesis, God said, God saw, you have the very same thing on the inside of you. And it produces just that way. It produces the very same way. It's automatic. What you believe is what manifests. It's a law. It's the law of faith. Well, then why isn't it working? Because you believe it's not working.
It is working.
Yeah. On what you believe. And you believe it's not working. Well, there's nothing wrong with your faith. It's productive and it's always producing. If you believe nothing, you get nothing. Nothing wrong with it, though. Stop being critical of it. It's doing its job. It's doing its job. It does what it's supposed to do and it works the way it's supposed to work. Everything that God gave you does. Everything He gave you, that He gave to you does. So what we have to stop doing is allowing the enemy to get us to use the tools God gave us against ourselves. But your faith works. It works. So then it's only one other area that we need to bring ourselves low in, and that's the area of love. So let's go back to Luke 17 and 1. This is the area that we must bring ourselves low in. This is the area that God is telling me to bring myself low in. This is how my year has been with the Lord since before the year got in here. Humility and love. This is all we've been talking about. Then saying here to the disciples, it is impossible, but that offenses will come. That means you can plan on two things. As long as the earth is here, seed time and harvest will remain. And you can count on somebody coming to offend you.
Yeah.
You can ask somebody being sent to offend you. You can count on it. It is impossible that offenses will come. But woe unto him through whom they come. It is better for him that a millstone will hang about his neck and he cast into the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones. Now look at this. Take heed to yourselves. If your brother trespasses against you, rebuke him. And if he repent, forgive him. And if he trespasses against thee 7 times in a day, and 7 times in a day turn again to you, saying, I'm sorry, I repent, I didn't mean it, forgive me. Then you shall forgive him. You shall forgive him. It's not a suggestion, it's a command.
Yeah.
It's a command. And the apostle said unto the Lord, increase our faith. But I just told you, there ain't nothing wrong with your faith. It ain't nothing wrong with it.
No.
You don't need to increase your faith. You need to humble yourself to that love command. You gotta humble yourself, man. This is the area that we must humble ourselves in. So let's go to Matthew 22:36. We know these scriptures. These are the love commandment scriptures that we are about to get. Matthew 22:36. How many in here can say that something has come to them to get them offended, to try to get them outside of love, to try to get them in strife?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Everybody in here. You can count on me. Master, what is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. Well, that counsels out not being obedient to him. That counsels out not acknowledging him and making decisions all willy-nilly. I'm consulting with him first. That counsels all that out, right? Not doing my own thing. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets, all the promises. All right, and let's go to John 15:9. So we are supposed to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength. All right? And not just love our neighbors as ourselves, but love them the way that Yeshua loves us. Because the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. He says, continue in my love. Y'all know the way that Yeshua loves, right? In your own time. Read 1 Corinthians 13. In your own time. Long suffering. Patient. And kind while you being patient. Think of not of herself. Seek of not her own. Is not easily offended. Read in your own time. We're not going there tonight. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love. even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. As I have loved you. He's so long-suffering. He's so gentle, and he's ever merciful, my God. As I have loved you. That's how I want you to love everybody else. Great love hath no man in this, than a man lay down his wife for his friends. As I have loved you. Don't go here, but we're not going here, but 1 John 4:16 said that God is love. Mm-hmm. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Mm-hmm. So God's desire that you, us, his children, would be at all times the living, breathing, walking, talking embodiment of love. Of divine love, the most powerful creative force in the universe, I heard Dr. Copeland say. Are you the embodiment of divine love, the divine presence of love? Is he dwelling? Are you allowing him to dwell in your thoughts? Are you allowing love? Are you making room for love to dwell in your heart? When somebody's in your face and they're talking to you for 2.5 hours, prophetess, 2.5 hours they were talking. What are you thinking? Are you allowing love to dwell in your thoughts? It's just one example. Are you allowing love to dwell? Are you allowing the presence of love himself to dwell in you with all your soul, to dwell in your soul? Are you keeping a mind ready to forgive? The Apostle Paul said he, because he knows offenses is coming, I wake up with the thought, I'm going to forgive. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to forgive. I'm not going to think a single evil thing. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to love with my mind, with my heart, with my soul, with all my diligence, with all my strength. I am going to love and show forth God's love. Are you letting him dwell in you that way? All of your being? Do you really allow him to permeate you? You know, when something permeates something, it's like it seeps through so much that you can't tell that it was ever two separate things there. They become one. Are you allowing love to himself to permeate you like that? To seep through all of your being? Love is the very presence of God. The anointing is the smearing on of his presence. That's all the anointing is. It's the smearing on of God himself, of love himself. This is the place of glory, of authority, of power, of miracles, signs, and wonders, of all manifestation. And then the CD that I have been studying, the pastor was the one that put me onto it, and I thank him for it, Living a Life Free of Strife and Offense. Dr. Copeland said the miracles and manifestations of the spirit and of the spiritual gifts, all of the creative miracle working power, was cut off in the body of Christ when the body of Christ became insubordinate to the love commandment. Remember we talked about power? People showing up to the church and they shouldn't see power. All right? It was cut off when the body of Christ became insubordinate to that commandment. The good news, remember I told y'all it was good news, the good news is that the same way power can be cut off, it can also be cut back on, just like a switch. Amen. Now you are anointed, you are called, you are chosen, and you have so much power in the Holy Ghost on the inside of you to break every yoke and to heal all that are oppressed of the devil the same way Yeshua did. To get wealth, because it's the same anointing. It's the same anointing to get wealth and bless and be a blessing in the earth. Will you humble yourself and surrender totally to the royal law? The love commandment, so and to the leading of the Holy Ghost, so that you can really be used by him the way that he wants to use you. So that he can exercise his power and ability and might through you. You have authority. You do. But what good is it to have anything and not be able to enjoy it or exercise it or use it? You have the most powerful one on the inside of you, the Holy Ghost. He has all ability, efficiency, and might, exhales us. thing that has to get done in the earth.
What good is it to have all that on the inside of you and he can't exercise himself or use you because you can't stay in love for 2 minutes? What good is it?
Because you want to stubbornly and pridefully remain insubordinate to what God has spoken. It's not worth it. Offense, unforgiveness, the little temper tantrums that we have in the flesh, or having pleasure in the flesh for a season. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Let's go to Jude 19, and this is our last verse for the evening. Jude 19. But in your own time, you can read 2 Peter 1, verses 1 through 11. Over there it talks about developing, talks about exercising and developing through exercising. Patience, brotherly kindness, love, diligence, all of the characteristics that you have in this divine nature that God has given you. Read it in your own time. Read it in your own time. And I dare you to ask God to help you develop and exercise in these things. I dare you. That's the same thing back there. But hey, offenses are coming anyway. You might as well develop and exercise and get developed through exercising. Jude 19. You might as well. I mean, you're going to get the opportunity anyway. Why not develop through it? These be they who separate themselves sensual, having not the spirit. But you, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And of some have compassion, making a difference. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Ask God to help you develop and be exercise. To exercise and develop yourself in these things. And he will. Don't look at it like, well, it shows that I don't want the opportunity to grow in patience. I don't want the opportunity to grow in love. Hey, you're going to get the opportunity to work it anyway. Ask God to help you. Mm-hmm. All right, and I said that was our last scripture. I'm sorry. But our last scripture is 1 Corinthians 16:9. If you do take the time to read 2 Peter, at the end of that, in verse 11, it talks about an abundant entrance being ministered unto you. Says that if you allow these things to abound in you and you abound in them, it's going to make you so that you'll neither be unbearing nor unfruitful in your Lord. That's what we want. We want to bear fruit. All right, it says, an abundant interest will be ministered unto you too in the kingdom of your Lord, our Christ. So, not only will you be able to always experience God's nearness and presence in you and the healing and restoration of your life, but he'll be able to come and minister to others through you as well. That's the height of life. For a great door and effectual is open unto me. It's been open unto all of us. And there are many adversaries who do not want you to go through that door. Are you going to allow the enemy, anything or anyone in this world, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, offense, unforgiveness, to stop you from having the spirit without measure? That's really what the question is. That's what God is calling us to. Are you going to allow anything to stop you? Think about people being saved, people falling down and wanting to be saved, Minister Green, just from hearing your voice. Are you going to allow anything? Your authority, the power and the glory and the honor that God has for you, are you going to allow anything to stop you from having that on this year when it's on the table? God forgive you. God gives grace to the humble, and he promises to cause all grace to abound towards you so that you will have all sufficiency in all things to abound to every good work. And he promises that if you will humble yourself where sin did abound, grace will much more abound to get you where he needs you to be and where he wants you to be, where you were supposed to be all along. You were put here to be a living testimony, okay? Some of the great men and women of God were Amy Semple McPherson, Oral Roberts, Kenneth Hagin, Smith Wigglesworth, Benny Hinn, Bishop Edebo. He's still in Pastor Al Madonna, though. A. Atman, these men who were here, some of them are still here. He's doing what he desires to do, and we hear about them and have heard about them. All right? So are you. You are great men and women of God. You were put here to be a living testimony. Allow God to make his mark in the earth through you. Allow him to. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. Allow him to. Don't be a living testimony unfulfilled in the earth. Don't rob God of the chance to be glorified in your life and to make the impact in the earth that he wants to make through you. That's all I have for you tonight. Amen. All I got, questions, comments, suggestions, whatever.